Now, the topic for today is the 101st Constitution Amendment. And also, what is happening today is that we are approaching 3 years of this GST implementation. And of course, the Constitution Amendment happened in 2016, much before the implementation of the GST. So let's just take a pause for a while and understand that what were the Constitution changes or the amendments which were essential and necessary for GST to be implemented. What has thereafter happened in terms of the constitutional challenges by way of various writ petitions which are filed in different states, different courts, how the courts have looked into these provisions for different diverse sectors, and so on and so forth. Let's just understand that in 2017, we were in a dynamic tax changing environment. It was not easy for any of the state government or even for the federal government to implement this GST. Even the Constitution Amendment, I still remember that debate which was there in the Rajya Sabha, the upper house. It was fabulous one to hear the discussion between Mr. Arun Jaitley and Mr. P. Chidambaram. So I think this constitution is a landmark victory as far as the implementation of the GST is concerned. But I think we will also look into certain aspects that why this constitution amendment was relevant, what are the main features of this amendment, how we have progressed in these 3 years, and how different legislative provisions have been enacted in light of this constitution amendment. So without wasting much time, let's just go to the GST. What is GST and how is GST defined in the Indian Constitution? Article 366, Clause 12A defines GST as means any tax on supply of goods or services or both, except taxes on the supply of alcoholic liquor for human consumption. I'll take a pause there. Alcohol has been excluded from the purview of GST within the Constitution, which means that as we speak, alcohol cannot ever come within the gamut of GST unless and until the Constitution is amended and Article 366 12A is amended to that extent. Another important aspect is that only alcoholic liquor for human consumption is being excluded. Now, which also raises the concern with respect to tobacco and tobacco products. Now, tobacco and tobacco products are actually subjected to GST and are also subjected to other taxes and cesses. Now, why that is very relevant is there are three products which were very important as far as the state exchequer was concerned: alcohol, tobacco, and petroleum products. So, and all of these three products have different consequences after this Constitution Amendment Act of 2016. Alcohol clearly out of the GST regime, will never be included in the GST regime unless and until there is a constitution amendment. Tobacco and tobacco products clearly within the GST regime, but with the brunt of additional cesses and duties on it. And petroleum products would remain out of the GST regime, but would come within the purview of the GST regime on the recommendation of the GST Council. Now, let's just understand what and how have services been defined, and why was that relevant to be defined in the Indian Constitution was also because of the relevant debates and discussions and litigation between what is goods and what is services. In the pre-GST regime, lot of disputes were there on classification of whether a particular activity would fall within the definition of service or would fall within the definition of goods. And that was more relevant from not only the rate perspective, but also from the perspective that who would get the benefit of the tax. So, for instance, if a supply is a service, there would be service tax applicability on it, and the tax would go to the federal government. If it's the case of goods, then there would be both the taxes, and in the way of VAT, the state tax, the central excise duty, and so on and so forth. Now, what Article 366 26A did to define services and how they define services is very interesting to observe. Services means anything other than goods. which means fundamentally, if services means anything other than goods, everything and anything which falls within the definition of supply becomes taxable, because you would be either goods, and if you're not goods, you would be squarely covered within the definition of services, which is included within the definition of the Constitution. So these two definitions become very important for us to understand the entire framework of this GST. And also with respect to the import, it was provided that these would clearly remain as an interstate transactions and subjected to IGST. Now, before I go to different provisions of the Constitution, there are two very important aspects of the Indian Constitution which we need to understand. I will read those provisions to you. The first one is with respect to Article A of the Indian Constitution, which came by way of this 101st Constitution Amendment Act, and how it reads: special provisions with respect to goods and services tax, clause 1, notwithstanding anything contained in articles 246 and 254, parliament and subject to clause 2, respect to the goods and services tax, or of services or both, takes place in the course of interstate trade or commerce. Which means now what happened as per the amendment of and incorporation of Article 246 capital A is that both the center and the state got the power to tax both the goods and services. So any goods and any service which would fall within the definition of supply would now be taxable both by the state government and by the federal government. But what also is clearly provided in the Constitution of India is that the parliament shall have exclusive powers when it comes to interstate supply of goods or services. And hence the concept of IGST, which is very, very innovative concept, was introduced. The next provision of the Constitution, which is very important for us to understand, is Article 269 capital A of the Indian Constitution, which provides for levy and collection of goods and services in the course of interstate trade or commerce. It provides that goods and services tax on supplies in the course of interstate trade or commerce shall be levied and collected by the Government of India, and such tax shall be apportioned between the Union and the states in the manner as may be provided by Parliament by law on the recommendation of the GST Council. So what has been provided is that as far as the levy and collection is concerned, it will be the Parliament which will be solely responsible for the levy and collection of these interstate transactions. So what happens in the interstate transactions today? There is a portion which gets apportioned even to the state government. So, for instance, we know for a fact that IGST is nothing but an aggregate of CGST and SGST. Now, what happens is, SGST portion goes completely to the state government. And with respect to the CGST portion, a portion of that also is divided, and a portion of that also goes to the state government. So, there is a ratio which has been agreed. So, which means that 50% goes to the state government for the IGST transaction, and for the balance portion of CGST portion, 52% goes. So effectively 76% goes to the state. Now let's understand that why this was important to be provided. It's not that just we wanted all of these state governments to be on board, but also because of the fundamental concept which changed. The concept which got introduced in the GST provision was with respect to the destination-based consumptions system. So Article 269 capital A of the Indian Constitution actually addresses that issue. So for instance, if the consumption of the goods actually happened in a particular state, the benefit of that tax should also ideally go substantially to that state. And hence this concept was introduced so that the tax collection also increases in the state where the consumption happens. The related point is with respect to the place of supply. Now, place of supply becomes relevant not only with respect to the transactions within the country, but also with respect to the inter-country transactions, so that we could determine that what is export, what is import, what is intrastate, and what is interstate. And hence, 269 capital A cross 5 is very relevant, and which provides that Parliament may, by law, formulate the principles for determining the place of supply and when a supply of goods or services or both takes place in the course of interstate trade or commerce. And we'll come to that. There are certain constitutional challenges even there. But yes, the place of provision needs to be determined, or the place of supply needs to be determined, not only for the transactions which are happening within the country, but also for those transactions which are happening between the Indian service provider and the service recipient outside of India, or the supplier in India and the recipient outside of India, and vice versa. Interestingly, Article 279 capital A of the Indian Constitution, which was incorporated by this 101st Constitution Amendment Act, provided that the GST Council shall be entrusted to recommend to the union and the state a lot of these issues which were listed there. There was a list, and it was the duty cast on the council to provide recommendation with respect to these issues or items. Now let's go step by step to understand, because this is very relevant, and this also basically is the report card of what the GST Council has done in these 3 years. So let's go step by step. What is the first one? The taxes, cesses, and surcharges levied by the union, the states, and the local bodies, which may be subsumed in the GST. Now, as far as these subsumption of these taxes are concerned, it was actually more of a role to be taken at the time of this constitution amendment and at the time of this implementation. Thereafter, much has not happened, and rightfully so, because the constitution provides for that list, what is included, what is excluded, and we'll come to that. But I would give marks to the GST Council, because most of the important decisions were taken at that point of time, except for few, which we will come in a while. The second issue for which the GST Council has to provide recommendation is with respect to the goods and services that may be subjected to or exempted from the goods and services tax. Now, in these 3 years, we have very, very closely monitored and have witnessed the rate swings which have happened. And there are so many rate swings which have happened, and any such rate change in the initial phase is not a very, very good thing to do, because what happens is that the businesses, especially the MSME sector and all, would not be able to change those rates while applying those taxes. So I think from that front, there were a lot of frequent rate changes, while that was the need of the hour for various supplies. So I think, it was a bit too much. If we talk about the GST models, I would give again good marks to the GST Council because of the innovative concept of the IGST and the settlement of these transactions between the federal government and the state through the GST network. So I think that's a good thing which has happened. Principles of levy, we will park that on the principles of levy, because principles of levy would include all of these levies, including the transitional taxes and cesses, etc. as well. So we will park that for the moment, and we will see that what issues have cropped up after implementation of GST. Apportionment of IGST, I think full marks should go to the system and to the GST Council. The recommendations were well taken and well discussed. With respect to the principles to govern the place of supply, I think there are no changes as of now which have happened in these 3 years. But yes, constitutional validity of the provisions of the IGST with respect to the place of provision or the place of supply have been challenged before courts, and we will come to that. So I think there, while GST Council has done a good job, but I think it becomes important for the GST Council now to address this issue of place of supply, so that the fundamental principle that the tax should be levied on the basis of the destination-based system is adhered to. So I think from that perspective, also place of provision needs, place of supply needs to be looked. Threshold limit, I would give marks to the GST Council because time and again, they've increased and rationalized those threshold limits. Rates, including flow rates with bands of goods and services tax, again, I think they have done some good number crunching with respect to the composition schemes and compliances and so on and so forth. So that is, again, a good thing which they have done in terms of the recommendation. To raise additional resources during any natural calamity or disaster, important issue. Can that rate be exorbitant is a question mark. I would not want to say whether they have done a good job or not, whether they have also imposed such taxes or cesses in times of other than natural calamity. So I would leave that. In terms of the special provisions and budgetary supports with respect to states such as Arunachal Pradesh, Assam, and so on and so forth, they have basically not done much. They could have done much more. And I think it is a sign wherein we need to see whether these states, which actually require more attention, what was promised to them in the earlier regime and how much has been transitioned in the current regime. There are various challenges. There are various repetitions with respect to these special provisions for these states, which we will come again in a while, that why these matters have not been addressed. So I think a lot can be done there with respect to that. And last but not the least, the GST Council was also supposed to provide a recommendation on the petroleum and petroleum products such as petroleum crude, high-speed diesel, motor spirit, natural gas, and aviation turbine fuel. So I think on those five products, petroleum products, there was supposed to be a recommendation. We have already gone ahead 3 years since inception of this GST. I think it is high time now that GST Council decides for inclusion of petroleum and petroleum products within the GST purview. The GST Council, it was agreed that would be guided by a need for harmonized structure and with respect to the development of a harmonized national market. So as far as the rates are concerned, there are certain cases where there are some cesses on some products in different states. But I think those should be kept as low as possible. There should not be any rate tweakings. But I think rate buying has gone after this GST, which is a good sign. Which is very relevant with respect to this constitution amendment before we go to those federal taxes which have been subsumed, is with respect to the compensation to the states. There was a specific provision, section 18 of the 101st Constitution Amendment Act, which provides that the state that the states where there is a loss of revenue would be compensated by the federal government for a period of 5 years by way of the Goods and Services Tax Act Compensation to State Act 2017. That 5 year period, the question today is whether that can be extended, whether that will be extended. I think we have two more years to go. And I think in 2022, that question will again crop up, whether that extension should happen. And mind you, this compensation to the state was not by way of any amendment to the Constitution, but only by way of the section which was included in the Amendment Act. Now, let's just quickly list those taxes which were subsumed. So it will give us a clear picture of what the Constitution had done and what could be done. So as far as the federal taxes which were subsumed, central excise duty, additional excise duties, excise duty under Medicinal and Toilet Preparation Act, service tax, additional customs duty commonly known as CVD, special additional duty of customs, entry 83 of the union list, central surcharges and cesses as far as they relate to the supply of goods and services, article 271, these were subsumed. State taxes which were subsumed was, of course, VAT, sales tax, entry 54, entertainment tax, central sales tax, octroi and entry tax, purchase tax, luxury tax, taxes on lottery, state taxes and surcharges. These were subsumed, these were part of the state list 7th schedule, which were subsumed, which with respect to the entries not subsumed, union list, basic customs duty, which we have today, terminal taxes on goods or passengers carried by railway, sea or air, taxes on railway fares and freight, which is applicable even today, entry 90, taxes other than stamp duties on transactions in stock exchange and future markets, which is applicable today, entry 92 capital A, taxes on sale or purchase of goods other than newspapers, where such sale or purchase takes place in the course of interstate trade or commerce, because there are certain products which are still being subjected to these tax, such as petroleum products and other products. Entry 92B, taxes on consignment of goods where such consignment takes place in the course of interstate trade or commerce. This is still relevant under the union list. Now, as far as the state list is concerned, what is applicable today is entry 49, taxes on land and buildings, so property tax. Entry 53, taxes on consumption or sale of electricity, which is a subject matter because electricity is also included within the purview of GST, of course at a nil rate, the exempted rate, but there's a state list entry also, entry 53, so which means that it is included in the state list by way of entry 53 and is also included within the purview of GST, so there could be some constitutional issues there. Entry 56, taxes on goods and passengers carried by road or on inland waterway. Entry 57, taxes on vehicles, whether mechanically propelled or not, suitable for use on roads, including tram cars. Entry 59, tolls. We still see and pay tolls, which is still a part of the state list, not subsumed within the GST. Profession tax by way of entry 60, which is there. And entry 63, the stamp duty, which has not been subsumed. And stamp duty is, of course, over and above the GST, which is being levied on the builders. So I think there is, again, a dual levy by way of the state list, entry 63, and the GST applicability. Now, why I wanted to, you know, highlight this is, one, so that we understand what are those taxes which are still applicable. That is one, even after these 3 years. Secondly, will there be a chance now for this government to basically exclude or trim down this list so that the GST base is broadened? So the intention was always to broaden the tax base and moderate the tax rate. And we have seen that in this time of economic crisis, when the GST collections have been coming down, I think it becomes more important for better compliance, rate rationalization, and inclusion of a lot of these things within the GST so that there is no loss of revenue, but it becomes easy also for the businesses. Now, I think we can wrap up this part A of this session with respect to the constitutional amendment which happened 3 years back. And of course, I will be going into the different writs which have been filed. I had the privilege and honor of arguing more than 100 writ petitions in different courts all across India. I have listed some 36 issues or 36 issues. And basically, most of these issues or probably all of these issues, I am arguing in one court or the other. You don't worry about taking the notes to these details of these writ petitions. We will circulate a note after this session, which you all of you will get, which will have some details of the constitution amendment portion, the part A of this session, which I have just concluded, and will also have details of all of these writ petitions, which I have clubbed into 36 headings. There are various writs, various issues, various courts, some ambiguities, some complexities, and so on and so forth. But we have tried to list that in this paper, which we would circulate to you and which you would get at some point of time, probably after the presentation. And we specifically did not want to share that before the session, because otherwise everybody would look into those details, what is written there. So before I will take a pause of 2 seconds or 2 minutes to just raise any fundamental questions When we go to the major writs which have been filed and argued, which are currently there at different courts, I would also want to talk about the types of writ petitions, because that's very important. When we go to the courts, a lot of time it happens, even sometimes seasoned lawyers struggle to give answers that which sort of writ petition is filed and what is being sought. So I think when it comes, which are there, and these type of writ petitions are very common. But there is one more, sixth writ petition, which is there, which is actually very important for everybody to basically see that that is also used at appropriate and correct time. So if we talk about the five most popular ones, this is writ of habeas corpus, which is probably used in case of GST, in cases of arrest, which is used to challenge the order of detention and prevention detention order under various statutes. So that's habeas corpus. Writ of mandamus. Writ of mandamus is basically a request by an individual and a consequent denial by the statutory authorities. So for instance, in the GST, there could be requests to process the refund claims on time, which are not happening, and hence the writ of mandamus would come into play. For directions, also a lot of times writ of mandamus is used, because at the end of the day, the court will have to give the direction to the lower authorities. So writ of mandamus comes into play. Writ of prohibition, the third one, it prevents the lower courts from exercising the powers which they do not possess. So writ of prohibition comes into play. Writ of quo warranto, which may not be very, very relevant for the GST purpose, is basically used to determine whether the holder of public office is validly entitled to it. So it could come probably for anti-profiteering authorities or DGAP and so on and so forth. Writ of certiorari, which is very, very commonly used, is the writ when the lower court or quasi-judicial authority passes an order without any authority to do so. This may come into play. But the most important one is the residuary writ, which includes the writ of declaration. A lot of times when we are moving on to the court just to challenge the vires of a provision, which means that when I have to challenge either the rules, or I have to challenge the circular, or I have to challenge the statutory provision also, then writ of declaration and writ of mandamus would come into play. And most of the times the courts would use the writ of declaration to declare a provision to be ultra vires. For instance, in the case of pre-import, which I would take up in my session, part two of this session, is that pre-import condition was held to be ultra vires the foreign trade policy. So, very, very specifically, we need to understand that what is the prayer which needs to go, whether this prayer should basically talk about challenging the vires of the provision or to read down the provision, and so on and so forth. Now, as a law student, I always used to feel that, and being both a chartered accountant and a lawyer, the mathematical part of the brain would say something else, and the other part of the brain would also tell me something else. So when we used to learn and read about Constitution, the question always used to come up was with respect to the equity jurisdiction. Now, equity jurisdiction, it is well settled before various courts that equity does not come into play when it comes to tax rates, which means that all sorts of fairness, etc., would not come into play when it comes to the tax provisions. And it is a settled law, fortunately or unfortunately. But in all of these 100 writ petitions which I have argued, while I may not have got the ruling from the courts that equity jurisdiction, whether these are applicable on to these tax rates or not, but I have used equity, because to me, the logic always comes first, because it is also related to arbitrariness under Article 14 of the Indian Constitution. So if something looks very illogical, if something looks like creating a hardship on to the businesses, I have always used that concept first to at least tell the court that what is the difficulty. And once the court is convinced that there is some sort of difficulty or hardship or arbitrariness or vagueness, so while there could be a situation that the equity may not come right from the word go, but I think most of these writ petitions are somehow based on equity, but at the same time have been concluded in a very, very different way with all legal parameters and all legal principles. And also, I think with these 3 years, if we look back these 3 years, a lot of these writ petitions have been addressed even by the GST Council. The council feels that, you know, there were certain issues which have come up, and these issues are very relevant and have addressed these issues. So there are certain of those writs also which have been addressed by the GST Council. So I think I will just take a pause and just understand from you, in case you have any questions so far. Would you want me to specifically address any of these issues, any sector specific issue which you want me to address? I'll be more than happy to take a pause and just note down what all needs to be incorporated in the next 80 minutes or so. You can please post your questions in the Q&A box. So I think I have got a question. So I've got the question from Kanika, and she says that what is the difference in amendment to article in Constitution and Amendment Act? Now, Kanika, what happens is that amendment to an article in the Constitution happens through an Amendment Act. Now, what it means is that, for instance, if I need to incorporate an additional section, let's say, in this 101st Constitution Amendment Act, let's say Article 279 capital A was included, right? So that would include by way of an Amendment Act. Similarly, if Article 246 capital A is to, or Article 286 is just to be amended, which is already there, the amendment to an article happens by way of an Amendment Act, but the amendment happens in the article, right? So the amended article, which basically comes into force, is after an amendment, which happens through the act. Kanika is also writing, can we have section and article references as notes, as you quoted in your speech? I will share a document to you which is something like this, which has all the details of this, including my notes. But yes, all of these relevant sections in all or articles we can include there. So nothing to worry. You will have something like this. If you want, I can share that document right now also. Let me just try. Is Ira there? Is it possible for you to share my document? Ira, I'm not able to share the document from here, I think. Will you be able to do that? So let's, before we go on to the writ petitions, let's just understand that what benefits we got by implementing GST regime. So if we were to conclude that, what were the benefits which have come? I think that will take us, you know, to a position wherein we will be able to weigh that how these writ petitions also address a lot of these issues, or are we looking just the darker side and not looking at the brighter side? So let's understand that what this GST did. When this GST came, it was basically announced that this is one nation, one tax, which means that as far as the tax is concerned, it came to the conclusion removal of raid buying. Now, why I say removal of raid buying? So for instance, if you see cars, cars were taxed at different rates in different states, right? So if I am residing in the state of Delhi, I would probably get my car registered from Haryana, from Gurgaon, which is the neighboring state, where the rates could be differ. Even if you see the petrol, the rates for petrol were different. Of course, petrol is not with the GST regime now, but these are some classic examples that you would go to a different state to get a supply. So raid buying disappeared. All fundamental principles came to the common page, because CGST Act becomes applicable to every with respect to the foreign investments which happened. If they were to put a plant in a particular state, they would always feel what are the taxes in those states, what would be the taxes in the other state, and so on and so forth. When it also comes to the fundamental provisions of levy, such as interstate transactions and so on and so forth, which would have common laws, but today even the interstate transactions would have common laws with respect to all of these levies and collections. So from that perspective also, it becomes very, very relevant to have GST. In terms of the deadlines, in terms of the refunds, tax payments, filing of returns, if I have operations in different states, the deadlines more or less remain the same unless and until there are exceptional situations. So from that perspective also, there is consistency. Also from the perspective of classification, today, whether it's a goods or services may have lesser relevance, because everything is subjected to tax under GST. There is Schedule 2, which provides for various of these ambiguous situations to classify whether it would fall within the definition of goods or for services. So there is more certainty with respect to those. So there are a lot of these things which came by way of benefits, and we can't say or conclude and deny that GST is a dark tax. It's actually very, very, very essential and necessary thing to happen. And even if we see the ease of doing business and the rating which has improved, it has improved significantly. So I think from somewhere 160 or something in 2016, we have now come to 63. So I'm not saying or concluding that 63 or 66 is a good rating, but I think there is a significant jump because of this implementation of GST. So I think with that background, let me start these writ petitions which were argued by me in different courts all throughout the country. You may have read or heard about the very recent case of brand equity before Delhi High Court, which is with respect to the transitional credit. Now, what was the issue in this case? The issue was that with respect to the transitional credit, there was a time limit prescribed in Rule 117 that I would get the benefit of this credit only when I file the trans one form within the stipulated period of 90 days. Now, for instance, if I missed the time limit of taking this credit within 90 days, the issue is whether this credit is my substantial right, whether it is my vested right, whether the delegated legislation provide for a time of 90 days without a statutory backing. What happens with respect to Article 300 capital A of the Indian Constitution, which says that there is a right to property? The credit which accrued to me in the pre-GST regime, which has been taken in the returns and properly availed in the pre-GST regime, if that is not transitioned to the current regime within 90 days, which is the period prescribed in law, can I rightfully challenge that period of 90 days and probably say today this period of 90 days is illegitimate, the delegated legislation cannot provide this period, it's my vested right. The right also comes to me by way of Article 300 capital A of the Indian Constitution, and hence can a situation be provided that the guidance be taken of the Limitation Act so that the residual provision of the Limitation Act to take this benefit within an extended period of 3 years is provided. So Delhi High Court passed a beautiful order, speaking order, and addressed all of this what I spoke, and basically provided that this 90 days is arbitrary, read down the provisions of Rule 117 and said that this credit can be taken in an extended period of 3 years. Now, why this decision became a landmark or a much discussed was because the benefit did not flow only to the petitioners. Delhi High Court clearly said that the respondent should publicize this so that all of these petitioners all throughout the country get the benefit of this credit, the transitional credit, within the period of 3 years. So there could be technical challenge, a technical glitch, or otherwise, even if in those cases where there were certain other reasons for assessees or the petitioners or people other than the petitioners not to claim that benefit within that period, they would get that benefit within an extended period by taking a guidance from the Limitation Act. So it was very interesting to argue this before the Delhi High Court. Now we will see how it gets settled at the Supreme Court level. The other issue with respect to the transitional credit was with respect to the pre-GST stock beyond 1 year. So which means that the GST transitional provisions had put the restriction that the stock which transitioned from the earlier regime to the GST regime, only the stock of last 1 year could be taken of that. So challenge that, I am arguing this matter before Delhi High Court, but as we speak, there are contradictory decisions of Bombay High Court and Gujarat High Court, and all of this will be settled before the Supreme Court. But where I argued this matter in Delhi High Court, what Delhi High Court said that let's just agree to give you an interim relief by which you can claim the credit. And once the matter is finally decided, you will have to take or decide, reverse or avail as per the final outcome. So I think transitional credits have been a subject matter of big disputes, debates, and so on and so forth. If the fundamental objective of GST was that there'll be seamless flow of credit, all of this credit, which became my right in the pre-GST regime, which is nothing but my vested right, which has been held in Eicher Motors and other cases, then why should there be any restriction of any sort for me to transition the credit, the erstwhile credit, to my current ledger's credit ledger system. Another issue which is very, very relevant and is before different courts is with respect to ITC accumulation on account of restrictions of rebate benefit and exclusion of transitional credits for computing net ITC. Now, what is happening is that in case you want to take the benefit of rebate, there are certain restrictions. So, for instance, if you are a deemed exporter or if you're procuring under advance authorization scheme, you would not get that rebate benefit. You would get only the refund benefit, which I have challenged in different courts. And also the exclusion of the transitional credits. Now, what also is happening is that with respect to this transitional credit, which has come from my earlier regime to the GST regime, the formula is devised in such a way that I do not get the benefit of that transitional credit, as this is excluded from the definition of net ITC. Now, I understand that these are all very technical issues. I'm trying to keep these issues in simple words, but in case you want me to elaborate on any of these issues, or you would want me to explain these issues in a more simpler words, I would be more than happy to do that. Or in case, even if you want me to repeat any of the issue, I can do that as well. And because we have some 36 petitions, I will not take much time on all of these or any one of these, but would try to move on. But we can come back again whenever you feel it is appropriate for us to come back. The other issue is with respect to the non-availability of input tax credit of goods and services which are used in the construction of immovable property. Now, what happens is that there are restrictions under Section 17.5C, 17.5D. In fact, there are a lot of restrictions in the block credit provisions under Section 17.5. So I have challenged 17.5C, I have challenged 17.5D, and these provisions are basically with respect to those properties or those goods and services which are used on own account with respect to these properties. It will be worthwhile for us to go into some of these provisions so that you will be able to better understand that what these restrictions are. So if I read provisions of Section 17.5C, we will read it from 17.5. It says that what the heading says, apportionment of credit in block credits. And 17.5 says, notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1 of section 16 and subsection 1 of section 18, input tax credit shall not be available in respect of the following, namely. And it goes to C, which says, works contract services, when supplied for construction of an immovable property other than plant and machinery, except where it is an input tax service for further supply of works contract services, which means that works contract services are taken as blocked credits or restricted credits when supplied for construction of an immovable property. D says what? D goes a step ahead and says that goods or services or both received by a taxable person for construction of an immovable property on his own account, including when such goods or services or both are used in the course or furtherance of business. The first fundamental question which now arises is that whether there could be any restriction with respect to the credits, because it breaks the chain. It is completely against the objective and fundamentals of GST. And even if I am doing the construction on my own account, and I am rendering taxable services from that building or premise, I should be eligible because it fundamentally defeats the purpose and objective of GST. Now, for a situation like today, wherein we are in economic slowdown, COVID situation, wholesalers not working properly, retail shops not working properly, factory shut down, there is again a provision of block credits under 17.5H, which says goods lost, stolen, destroyed, and the most important is destroyed, because a lot of these shoes, bags, and so on and so forth would be destroyed in this situation where these factories and shops. to these writ petitions. The other issue is with respect to the denial of transitional credit on capital goods procured by units in exempted zones. So we know that there are these exempted zones where we have where we had those exemptions or the benefit of putting up the factory, etc., in those areas. And what has happened is that there were a lot of these benefits which were promised there in those exempted areas zone, which have discontinued. In fact, the petition which I am arguing is with respect to the denial of the transitional credit on capital goods. So, for instance, if the capital goods were procured just 1 year prior to this GST implementation, there is a denial with respect to those credits which we are challenging. Today, the GST provisions also provide that the benefit would be available over the period of 5 years for these capital goods. So why that proportionate benefit should not come within the GST time frame with respect to these capital goods remains a question mark. Another issue with respect to the transitional credit is with respect to cesses into the GST regime. We are basically arguing matters today with respect to the education cess, Rishi Kalyan cess, secondary and higher education cess, which was availed in the erstwhile regime, but which was restricted due to the amendment effected in the CGST Act. The other relevant point is that this amendment is retrospective, which means that today, at the time of transition, if somebody one had availed that transitional tax and has taken that to the credit ledger account, there was a retrospective amendment which happened thereafter. And then that person is required to reverse that tax credit on those cesses. The question which now arises is also with respect to the retrospective applicability with respect to such amendments. We know for a fact retrospective amendment in tax laws are only done in rarest of rare cases. These retrospective amendments are generally done in those cases where there was visible that the assessees or the taxpayers were taking undue advantage of the situation, or that there was any malafide or nuisance which was going on. But with respect to these transitional cesses, there is nothing of that sort which happens, and hence it becomes very, very relevant for us to understand that whether in actual terms or actual way this transition can happen or not. Also, the related point is with respect to the non-availability of ITC on non-fulfillment of export obligations. So, for instance, if I was taking benefits of different schemes and I had to fulfill an export obligation, but I could not fulfill that export obligation, I do not mind paying the amount which needs to be paid. But if we see the pre-GST regime, that amount which you would pay due to non-fulfillment of the export obligation, you would get that. There are clear restrictions under the GST law with respect to this non-fulfillment, which we have challenged in Delhi High Court. As I had mentioned before, with respect to certain taxes which were subsumed, entertainment tax clearly was subsumed. But we should also remember that a lot of these multiplexes in India, they were given these benefits of entertainment tax incentive schemes, which means that they could collect the entertainment tax from the consumer, but could put and keep them in their pockets, which means that that would come by way as an incentive to them. Or there could be complete waiver of 10% depending on different schemes. Now, what has happened after moving into the GST regime is that most of these benefits with respect to the entertainment tax were basically also wiped away, which means that all of these benefits which were promised either by way of refund, either by way of keeping that money back or non-applicability of these entertainment tax, these benefits were curtailed for most of the states. We filed writ petitions for different multiplexes and other people on whom these entertainment taxes were applicable to get some sort of relief. At least some sort of relief with respect to the state taxes have come. But I think at the end of the day, the constitutionality or the continuation of all of these benefits which were promised in the earlier regime will have to be tested. So we have multiplexes today who are struggling. We have water park, theme parks, etc., which are struggling. We have other players, entertainment tax was applicable, which are struggling. So I think it will be seen that how in the days ahead, this issue of non-extension of this benefit, which was promised in the pre-GST regime, gets now translated into actual benefit. So we'll have to get into more details, and there'll be a lot of discussion with respect to these benefits which were promised. The related issue is with respect to the budgetary support, which I had also earlier mentioned, that these budgetary support schemes based on which there was a lot of investment which had happened in those states which were industrially backward. Most of these benefits have been curtailed in some way or the other. The question which now arises is that this huge investment which has happened based on the promise of the state, is there a legitimate expectancy of the industry to address, approach to the authorities or the government today and say that, you know, huge investment has happened based on this promise and based on the legitimate expectancy principle, would they be eligible to get the benefit of these schemes which were promised to them in some way or the other? There was one writ which was filed in 2017, which was with respect to the legal services, which we had argued from the perspective of the forward charge applicability for LLPs, which provide legal services. So LLPs were excluded from the reverse charge for legal services. And we wanted all of these legal services to be within the same tax bracket, and collection should be in the same way. And hence that writ petition was filed, but just thereafter completely addressed very, very quickly by the GST Council. IGST on ocean freight, I have been arguing this writ in multiple courts for multiple clients in diverse sector. IGST on ocean freight, as we speak, there is a Gujarat High Court decision which is already there to basically provide that IGST cannot be levied on ocean freight. Now, what happened in this case of ocean freight was that on the value of this goods imported, the CIF value, there was deemed to be a value with respect to the ocean freight. Generally, what would happen is that all of this, so basically in the GST regime, there is a clear definition of the service provider and the service recipient. As far as the ocean freight was concerned, in all of these cases, when the CIF transactions are concerned, cost, insurance and freight are already included in the transaction, which means that for the freight, it is not the importer who's paying for that freight, but it is the person other than the importer, that is the exporter, who's paying for the freight. So how could tax be levied on a person who's not privy to the transaction, who does not have any privity of contract with respect to this transaction? And if the freight provider is situated outside of India and is rendering the services to the service exporter outside of India, the transaction is between two non-residents, and hence there should not be any GST applicability on a deemed value of with respect to the ocean freight. The Gujarat High Court categorically held it to be ultra vires, and it will be seen that how this issue is now addressed by Supreme Court, because a lot of petitions were disposed of in Gujarat, but as we speak, there are petitions in different courts as well. So I think all of these would now be heard and clubbed together in the times ahead. Another interesting aspect was with respect to levy and collection of social welfare surcharge and cesses on imports made under using scrips. So what happened in this case is that when you scrips and these MEIS scrips and SEIS scrips, and you import your products or supplies using these scrips, the basic customs duty is exempted, basically because of usage of these scrips. Now, if social welfare surcharge is to be levied on BCD, which means that let's say BCD is 10 rupees and the social welfare surcharge is 3%, it becomes applicable on 10. And in case of usage of the scrip, if the basic customs duty is zero, then it is a fundamental mathematical principle that if something as a percentage is made applicable to zero, it becomes zero. So if basic customs duty is zero, social welfare surcharge should also be zero. The notification clearly says that there is an exemption with respect to the basic customs duty when these scrips are used, and hence there should not be any applicability with welfare surcharge. In fact, there is a circular which has also come after one of the decisions of one of the jurisdictional courts that the debit would be made from the scrip value with respect, should not be made from the scrip value, but should be paid in tax. And that circular has also been challenged by us in a high court. So I think social welfare surcharge, that remains the question mark. And it looks like that this argument will be very interesting to see that how exemption is looked into, and if there is an element of tax which is there on an exempted product, would that be exempted as well. One of the first set of writ petitions, and certainly the landmark decision, the first landmark decision on GST, was by Delhi High Court, and I had the privilege to argue that matter before Delhi High Court. And here again, most of the arguments were based on equity jurisdiction, that how working capital issues would now be faced due to the implementation of GST. And this issue was with respect to the advance authorization licenses. If we take a pause and a step back, the advance authorization license holders were given a lot of exemptions to import duty because for a fact that they were exporters, and there is no point in levying tax on them because it is not a working capital issue. And it's a pass-through. So all of the advance authorization license holders could import goods without payment of duty. But when GST came, somebody wants to make some point? Can you please mute everyone? So when it came to advance authorization scheme and the implementation of that scheme in the GST regime as well, the question was that these advance authorization license holders who had the benefit promised to them for import of certain products based on the exports which they had done prior to that getting that license, can that benefit be curtailed in the GST regime? And what had happened in the GST regime was that there was no provision for them to import goods without payment of IGST. And hence that question came before the Delhi High Court, wherein the Delhi High Court passed an interim order and thereafter passed the final order that the benefit of this advance authorization to those license holders who would have committed the transactions with their customers prior to the GST, this benefit should continue and this benefit should be extended to the period even after the GST regime. And of course, the revenue filed an SLP before the Supreme Court, which was also dismissed in Supreme Court. So very interestingly, this issue with respect to advance authorization was addressed by courts, by Delhi High Court and then settled by Supreme Court. But what happened in this period while these matters were being argued with respect to these advance authorization, there was a sort of an amendment which happened prospectively with respect to the benefit to be given to these. So the challenge before the court remained only for a particular period, but for the period after October 17, this benefit came that they could import without payment of IGST if they hold an advance authorization. But that came with the imposition of a pre-import condition. Now, if you would ask me that what is this pre-import condition, I would say that this, I have no clue. I would say that I have no clue because that's the very, very relevant ground which I used in the court to say that this pre-import condition is vague. And I use the principle of void for vagueness to basically substantiate before the Gujarat High Court in a batch of petitions. I think I was representing and arguing for 5-6 of them to basically prove that this pre-import condition is vague. And based on the decision of the Supreme Court in Shreya Singhal, which was with respect to those IT Act, this section 66A of the IT Act, which is for those messaging, vulgar messaging, etc., and all that menace which was created, Shreya Singhal decision before the Supreme Court laid down this principle and explained this concept of doctrine of void for vagueness. That very concept was used with respect to the pre-import condition as well, and Gujarat High Court held pre-import condition to be ultra-vires the foreign trade policy. The Gujarat High Court was very, very categorical to held that this pre-import condition is void, not defined, arbitrary, defeats the entire purpose of the benefit, creates hardship and so on and so forth, and is ultra-vires the foreign trade policy. So our SLPs before the Supreme Court, but these petitions are there not only in Gujarat High Court, but in various courts where I am arguing these. And of course, all of these will finally be decided by Supreme Court. But today, as we speak, if there are certain DRI notices, if there is some hardship and so on and so forth, of course, the decision of Gujarat High Court can be used by the taxpayers. Another very interesting issue is with respect to the taxability of intermediaries, where it challenged the place of supply for intermediaries. Interestingly, Section 13(8)(b) of the IGST Act has been challenged. Now, this is one of those issues where I'm challenging the place of provision for a service provider. What means is that the rules may or may not be in place, the circular may or may not be in place, but what I'm saying is that the statute which determines the place of supply for intermediary services, that is against the principles of the Constitution. Now, what I'm saying is that, so what is the current law? Let's understand. The current law is that if the service provider is in India and the service recipient is outside of India, and these intermediaries are nothing but brokers or buying agents and so on and so forth, the place of provision for this service or the place of supply will be in India, which will be against the residual or the default rule, which is default provision, which is there in Section 13. Which means that if the place of provision is in India, now what happens is that the service provider is in India, the service recipient is outside of India, payment is received in convertible foreign exchange, the consumption of the service happens by the service recipient outside of India, he consumes those services, but because the place of provision is in India, there is no benefit with respect to the tax, which means tax becomes applicable on these intermediaries, these services to the recipient outside of India. Now, let's draw an analogy. after this writ petition, which we were arguing in different court. Now, what has happened is that they have come out with a notification which says that if ultimately the goods move to India or move to a place other than India, then there will be benefit in those cases where the goods do not come to India, which means that if I am an agent helping a customer, my customer who's outside of India, and he sells the goods from outside of India to some other country outside of India, then there'll be no tax. But if these goods come to India, there'll be tax. So an analogy would be that, for instance, if I am an investment banker and I am in advising my customer in New York, if he invests based on an advice in India, then it becomes taxable. But if he invests in London Stock Exchange or New York Stock Exchange, then it doesn't become taxable. So which means that the transaction of the service between the service provider and the service recipient has been overlooked. The consequential effect of that service has come into play to give the benefit of exemption only in a particular case, but not to give that benefit in the other case where the consumption of the final goods or the services happen in India. So from that perspective, this is completely arbitrary. There are certain provisions with respect to the Constitution also which were argued there. And let's see, because the matter is still sub judice, the hearing has been concluded. But if this order comes, I'm sure that it will be a beautiful order, which will be worth to read. Every part of it will be worth to read. This will be the first order which will substantially challenge the place of supply, which will substantially challenge the statutory provision in light of the constitutional provisions. And hence the amendments to the Constitution in 2016 has very, very important role to play. If this decision comes as a positive decision to the industry, I'm sure it will be a landmark decision and will be worth to read for years and years ahead. So, and based on this decision, there'll be a lot of other decisions which are, different writs which are today pending, which will actually determine the course of writs for different issues. So very closely, this needs to be watched. The hearing, I'm repeating, has been concluded. So beyond a point with respect to the Constitution, I would not want to comment as of now, but let's wait with a bated breath to see how this is ultimately decided by Gujarat High Court. Two very interesting topics, anti-profiteering and arrest provisions. Both of these are actually full topics within themselves, but let's try to cover as much as possible. As we speak today, I am arguing anti-profiteering writs for about a dozen of clients, real estate, FMCG, and food and beverages sector. These are three big sectors which are which have got the brunt of anti-profiteering, and I am arguing these for all of these three sectors in Delhi High Court. All of these matters are being heard in Delhi High Court because of the presence of NAA in Delhi, which is National Anti-Profiteering Authority. So let's just understand that what the anti-profiteering provisions are. Section 171 of the CGST Act basically provides that any reduction in the output tax rate or any incremental value with respect to the credits on the input side, the benefit has to be passed on to the consumer by way of commensurate reduction of prices. Now, what is vague here is commensurate reduction of prices. What are the two factors here? The output tax and the input tax. Are these the relevant factors? Yes, they are the relevant factors. But are these the only factors? The answer is no. These are not the only factors, because the anti-profiteering is nothing but commensurate reduction of prices. It is not actual reduction of prices. So which means that if there is a concept used such as commensurate reduction of prices, the factors other than these relevant factors will also come into play. The biggest irony of the situation is that when the anti-profiteering authorities want businesses to determine the quantum of profiteering, it is interesting to note that there is no methodology to determine the quantum of profiteering, which means that it is left upon to me to determine that what is the quantum of profiteering. I may use, for instance, in case of real estate players, the actual loss of credits, but the anti-profiteering authorities may say that the ratio of ITC to the taxable turnover is a relevant ratio. Now, even if we use that ratio, there is hell lot of inconsistency. The ratio ranges from 0.5% to 9.5%. If that's the level of inconsistency with the formula which they want to use, of course, it will lead to absurd results. So the moot point which now comes up is that in the absence of the methodology to compute profiteering, can businesses be required to pass on this benefit and with penalties and interest? So what I have done is challenged the provision of Section 171 of the CGST Act, especially in light of the fact that there is no methodology to determine the quantum of profiteering, and let's see how it goes. This is the crux of the anti-profiteering problem, but I have dozen of grounds and dozen of reasons to go to the court for different such issues before the NAA and the orders passed by the National Anti-Profiteering Authority. Arrests. Now let's come to arrests. And I had the privilege of arguing the landmark decision before the Bombay High Court, which was the Supreme Court, and wherein the Supreme Court clearly held that the court would not interfere at that moment when the matter was heard. Now, what is this entire arrest controversy? The arrest controversy is predominantly for two situations. One, circular trading. Two, bogus invoices. So let's understand what is circular trading. Circular trading, in simple words, is, let's say, A sales to B, B sales to C, C sales to D, and D sells it back to A. That's called circular trading. The other point which is relevant for circular trading is whether on each of these transactions is there a loss of credit or is there non-applicability of tax. If there is a tax applicability on each of these transactions between A to D and back from D to A again, then there is no leakage of tax. Everybody pays tax on the output, avails the credit. And hence, as far as the GST tax evasion is concerned, there is no GST tax evasion. Any money laundering or any other provision, or basically turnover is jacked up because of these transactions, that has nothing to do with GST. And accordingly, and as a corollary, the point which comes up is whether an arrest can be made in a situation when there is no leakage of GST. That's the first fundamental point. The second fundamental point is when I argue these bail applications or anticipatory bail and so on and so forth, what is the purpose of jail? The purpose of jail is that the person who is sent to judicial custody does not influence the witnesses, does not remove the evidence, and should not run away by not paying the taxes. Now, if we see about the evidences, in any case, all data is there within the GST network. When these investigations happen, all of these big teams come and they take all servers, computers, data, and so on and so forth. As far as the witnesses are concerned, the statements are recorded for all the witnesses. And as far as the tax payment is concerned, the tax is paid by each of these trading business. So from the perspective of that, I think it is very clear that arrest should not be made in such circumstances wherein it can easily be proved that there is no leakage of the taxes. Now, when it comes to bogus invoices, also the issue is, if the person who has got the invoices has paid the consideration and the tax to the person who has rendered the service, it becomes essential to see whether there is any revenue leakage. If there is no revenue leakage, then I think from that perspective also, see, I'm not concluding whether what a person has done is right or wrong. But what I'm saying is that arrest or jail is not the right way to handle this. In fact, somebody told me that in Tihar jail in Delhi, there is a complete separate cell of GST. At one point of time, I was informed that there are some 600 people of GST fraud who are there. So I think that's not the right way, these proceedings could happen. But yes, other mechanism is there to ensure that there is no revenue loss if the revenue loss has happened. And in those cases where there is no revenue loss, I think there is no question of arrests being made. So I think those are some of these interesting points which we have seen in these last 3 years, wherein a lot of these arrests have happened, a lot of these matters with respect to anti-profiteering have gone to the court. Now let's just move a little ahead by talking about some of these issues for builders, where I challenged the taxability of transfer of development right in Bombay High Court. What I argued was that this transfer of development right is nothing but akin to sale of land. When the development right is given by the society or the members to the builder, that is basically transferring the right in the land. And if we see the MOPA provisions, if we see the provisions with respect to the stamp duty, this is nothing but like sale of land. And if sale of land and building is excluded from the GST purview, why should that be taxable? In fact, there are a lot of other issues related to the builders also with respect to these proportional reversals, tax rate without an option, contractor and subcontractor different rates, block credits, and a lot of these issues. And most of these issues I have taken to the court. In fact, with respect to the transfer of development right, the issue which comes is that there is a notification which determines the point of taxation or the time of taxing the development right. But the question is, if something is not taxable, then by way of a notification, could you determine the point of taxation for that supply which is not taxable at all? And that was the limited point before the Bombay High Court. Now, there could be other issues, such as issues for the casinos, which I'm arguing in Goa, with respect to the government license fee paid by these casinos. Now, if the fee is paid by the casinos to the government, to the state government, by way of the casino license fee, the question is whether this would tantamount to a service being rendered by the state government to the casino. This levy in itself is a statutory levy. If it's a statutory levy and is being levied as a sovereign function of the government or the state government, could there be an element of GST under the reverse charge for that license fee? Is the question before the Bombay High Court Goa bench. Tax cascading for publishers, inverted duty structure. We know that the GST came into effect by giving some provisional benefits with respect to the inverted duty structure. What is inverted duty structure? So if I have my supply which is taxed at a lower rate and I have larger pool of credits with me, the credits which remain unutilized with me are eligible for refunds. Now, what happens in lot of situations such as books, hospitals, education, and so on and so forth, the output is exempt, but there is a high input tax cost. If we see the directive principles of the Constitution, there is right to education, right to health, right to life, and so on and so forth, right to legal aid. None of these directive principles provide for that. And for that very reason, there are exemptions given for essential services. Now, if these exemptions are given for essential services or for essential supplies, such as books, which are exempted, there is a tax credit which becomes a cost, and there is a clear case of tax cascading and defeats the entire purpose of the exemption. So, for instance, if we take books, for example, There is paper, which is taxed at 12%. There is ink, which is taxed at 18%. Royalties to authors is taxed now under both the reverse and the forward charge after a writ petition, but is still taxed, remains a cost for the publisher. So all of this becomes cost. There is a clear case of tax cascading, and the entire benefit of exemption goes for a toss. And so that's the question which is there before the Delhi High Court. In fact, the same petition also included the provision with respect to procurements from unregistered dealers. Fortunately, after our writ petition, that change has come in, wherein that amendment has happened that if you procure from the unregistered dealer, you would not be required. The GST regime, then the person who's purchasing from those would be subjected to tax. It defeated the purpose of threshold exemptions. It led to a situation wherein I would not want to deal with unregistered dealers, and hence all of these small dealers or suppliers would be at a disadvantage. And that was very, very appropriately argued by me before Delhi High Court, which fortunately has been addressed by the GST Council, and there are notifications which have been issued to address this issue completely and to remove that anomaly of reverse charge applicability for procurements from unregistered dealers. Now, respect to the IGST levied by services for services by banks in India to foreign branches, there was a writ petition for a bank which was filed. The constitutional validity of tax was challenged because the export provisions clearly provide that when these services are rendered by a head office or a branch in India to its counterpart outside of India, while the consumption happens outside of India, the benefit of export would not be eligible and it would not qualify for that benefit. And hence that was, while all other conditions were met, that place of provision was also met. This exclusion from or a condition in the rules for export became a subject matter of dispute, which was there, but it was actually withdrawn for some reasons. The petition was finally not decided, but thereafter the amendment came to give this benefit. After our writ petition was argued a couple of times, this benefit came by way of an amendment to grant this benefit from 2018. So the dispute now is only with respect to the period prior to this amendment. In case of insolvency, also there are certain issues. So for instance, if a company becomes insolvent and there is an insolvency proceeding which has been admitted against that company, the question is with respect to the prior taxes. The GST system is designed in such a way that you have to first the prior period, and only thereafter you would be eligible to get the benefit with respect to the payment of taxes for the subsequent periods, which means that if on 1st of April there is an insolvency proceeding which is admitted, I will have to pay taxes after 1st of April. I can pay that only when I clear all my past debts with respect to, or defaults with respect to, the GST. Now, as far as the insolvency proceedings are concerned, there is a provision of moratorium which kicks in. So what happens is, as per this provision of moratorium, the IRP who is appointed is subjected to pay the taxes only for the subsequent period and is not required. But because of the systemic issue, you have to pay taxes. So we have approached the court with respect to those issues also, because in terms of the priority, that money may not be due to the central government, which has to file the claim as either the financial creditor or as the operational creditor. And the amount may go in a different ratio to the central government. And hence this question came before the Gujarat High Court, and subsequent to this petition, there are certain changes which have been implemented in the system on recommendations of the GST Council, so that this anomaly is appropriately reduced or removed. I know there are certain participants which are there from the power sector, and levy of GST on renewable energy certificate scripts in the power sector has been a subject matter of debate. I'm arguing about a dozen of these writ petitions in Delhi High Court, wherein we have challenged the levy of GST on renewable energy certificate per se. What we are saying is that these RECs are nothing but scripts which are traded on an exchange, which is nothing but very akin to the stock exchanges. And these, because these are scripts, these are traded on these stock exchanges, there should not be any GST applicability on these REC scripts. And let's see how this matter is finally decided before courts in Delhi. Physical export on EPCG license. There are certain issues which have been created due to the changes in the definition with respect to meeting the export obligation. So, for instance, if a particular supply or of goods or of services was eligible for counting towards meeting the export obligation, but the corresponding change after the GST regime has led to the situation that that supply would not be counted towards my fulfillment of export obligation, it creates a hardship. At the time when the license was issued to me, a particular category was eligible for that benefit, but if it is curtailed in some way or the other at a later stage, that has been challenged by us. With respect to whether a recovery could be made from the shareholder of a company, we have taken the matter to Bombay High Court and have got a favorable order that any GST default or any tax default which is being tried to be recovered from the shareholder is not the right way. The jurisdiction has been challenged there as well. Another issue is with respect to the double taxation on imported goods stored in customs bonded warehouse. There was a problem with respect to these goods stored in customs bonded warehouse. On the movement, there was double taxation. And subsequent to our writ petition, this issue was addressed. And there is a corresponding notification which came to give this benefit so that the double taxation problem is resolved. This petition was argued by us in Delhi High Court. That has been resolved. Exemption of GST on domestic procurements by R&D centers. There were R&D centers who were eligible to import goods without payment of duty as per specific provisions of Department of Scientific and Industrial Research notifications. These were certified by these research institutes for carrying on the research in India. But after this GST, there were issues. In Haryana High Court to ensure that these forms are available for those products which are not under the GST regime so that benefit of taxes, the reduced rate of taxes flows. That is again being addressed very pragmatically by courts already and is implemented in various states across India. Target Plus scheme, in fact, there is, as we speak, a recent Target Plus scheme which has been introduced based on investment. And what had happened in this writ petition, which we have taken with respect to the Target Plus scheme, in spite of the clear directions from the Supreme Court and the order of the Supreme Court, it was not implemented in terms of the monetary relief. We have taken that matter before Bombay High Court, which is again very, very interesting to see that how these Target Plus schemes are in actual way the benefit is being given to the Indian exporters. And that will have very, very big relevance even for the recent Target Plus schemes, because that will set up the mood and temperament of all the investors and the exporters here in India. Cryptocurrencies, very interesting. RBI had issued a circular banning cryptocurrencies in India. We had challenged that circular based on various different parameters, including doctrine of void for vagueness. And Article 19 1G, right to carry on business or profession, We had challenged that RBI circular prohibiting provision of banking services and GST issues in relation to virtual currencies. We had also challenged the arbitrariness with respect to the taxability in terms of the valuation to determine this cryptocurrency, whether the valuation of the supply for cryptocurrencies would be on the value including the cryptocurrencies or would be only on the margin what the exchange earns. Interestingly, it has been held by Supreme Court that RBI circular prohibiting provision of banking services is arbitrary, and hence cryptocurrency exchanges could now appropriately work with all eligible and legitimate banking channels. And it is now very, very clear that that RBI circular which imposed such restrictions illegal and vague. Now, there are other issues such as issues pertaining to interest. There are contradictory decisions with respect to whether interest is payable on gross liability or net liability, which means that if there is a delay in payment of tax, but I had certain amount in my credit ledger account, whether I would pay the interest on the gross liability or I would deduct that amount which was already there in my ledger account. There are contradictory decisions there with respect to these issues of interest. Further, various high courts have held that recovery of interest prior to adjudication is not permitted. So if there is an order for recovery of interest, but the adjudication is not complete, then I think there is an issue with respect to that also, where the courts are very, very clear with respect to the timing when this interest has to be paid. Taxability of damages and liquidated damages is again a subject matter of debate and discussion, not only under the GST regime, but also under the pre-GST regime. Now, the essential element with respect to damages is that there is an absence of service. So, for instance, if I go and take a room in a hotel and by mistake I break that lamp which is there or break the TV screen, the question is that the amount which is being paid by me towards those damages, is there an element of service? So clearly there is an absence of service. Any activity under the GST regime becomes taxable only when it is a supply includes both goods and services. We will have to see where it falls in the definition of services. So liquidated damages is clearly out of the GST regime. This is basically, and there are then certain issues with respect to the availment of ITC not reflected in form GSTR 2A and the timing of whether these could be taken at the time when this GSTR 2A was to be filed or not. So there are a lot of these issues which have gone to the court. So if I were to summarize, there are issues where the courts have decided and have held these to be unconstitutional. There are issues which went to the court. The GST Council came up with the recommendation to address those issues. And there are issues which are today being decided by the court, but SLPs are there before the Supreme Court. And there could be issues which are today, as we speak and as we present, are there before the courts. And it looks and appears that the courts may take the view sooner than later. So with that, I would want to conclude more or less this session, but happy to address any of the questions which you feel are relevant, which I need to answer. And of course, you will get this document, which has the summary of all of these petitions, which are very relevant today, are major petitions, and with the background to the constitutional provisions. Any questions, please?
Sir, who is there? घर पे बैठ के ज्यादा हो रहा है। जीवन का क्या करे थे? कंधे से थाली पिट करे थे। अरे
So there are questions which are coming up. So let me just take these questions one after the other. Why had Article 366-29A been retained even after the 101st Constitution Amendment? What could be its implication on GST law? Shraddhar Mehta has raised this question. It is a very, very interesting question. In fact, if you would read my commentary on GST, the fourth revised edition, and even the earlier edition printed by Taxman, I have completely written on this, that this has been missed. So it appears that this has been missed. This deletion, and hence it is absolutely relevant that this is amended at appropriate time so that this problem is addressed. I have addressed that in my commentary as well. Let me tell you. So this is a very nice question and thought, and I think if somebody has read the Constitution, would understand that this has been missed and this needs to be amended at appropriate time. So I will send you, in fact, a page on this, which will basically give the view with respect to this, and I will just check with Piki if I can send that to you in some way or the other. So that has been missed. There may not be answer to that, but yes, of course, that's a problem. So that's one. Then I'll go to the next one. Manoj is writing that when GST is for place of consumption, then which state should get tax while billing to A in one state and shipping to B in other state? Now, Manoj, what the law provides is that when the transaction is interstate transaction, IGST becomes applicable. When IGST becomes applicable, the provisions of the destination-based consumption comes into play. The IGST model is worked in such a way that the substantial, because IGST would also be used as credit by the person who is actually getting the purchase, he would use that IGST credit to offset his liability. Now, he could have liability of either IGST or CGST plus SGST, and he would use this IGST credit to offset his output liability. But as far as the IGST is concerned, it is designed in such a way that the consumption state or the buyer who gets the brunt of that gets the benefit, and the system addresses it in such a way that the appropriate benefit is being provided to the state where the consumption happens. Now, IGST is nothing but the aggregate of CGST and SGST, which means that 50% in any case goes to the state. The balance 50%, which is with respect to the CGST portion, a substantial portion of that also by way of interstate settlement or the settlement between the federal government and the state government is being given to the states. Shraddha is writing, how is ITC प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ एन एसएससी. नाउ दैट वाज द एंटायर कंट्रोवर्सी श्रद्धा बिफोर द दिल्ली हाई कोर्ट. नाउ इमेजिन अ सिचुएशन वेयर इन आई हैव मनी इन माय पेटीएम और आई हैव मनी इन माय बैंक अकाउंट. If I'm not using that money for a particular period for some reason, for some procedural defect or for some procedural or technical reason, will that money not remain my money? Now, when it comes to input tax credit, Eicher Motor basically says that it is my vested right. Now, Article 300 capital A provides that anything which is my property, I will have substantial right to that property. And accordingly, when the input tax credit, which was with respect to the transactions of the earlier regime, came to me in my account, the credit ledger and so on and so forth, or the returns of the earlier regime, I have availed that benefit. That amount or credit is mine. Now it needs to be transitioned to the subsequent regime, and that's only a process or a procedure. If that right which accrued to me in the earlier regime, even the provisions of Article 174 of the CGST Act provides that that benefit should come to me by way of the transition to the current regime. And if we see this provision, how it reads is, repeal and saving, it says, and I'll go to straight to the repeal of the said amendments and of the said acts and amendments shall not, I will go to C, affect any right, privilege, obligation or liability acquired, accrued or incurred under the amended act or repeal acts or orders under such repeal act or amended act, affect any duty tax and so on and so forth, right? So all of these are, it is very clear, it affect any right, privilege, obligation or liability. So your question is, and it says accrued or incurred under the amended act. Now your question is that how is it my right? Now, the credit becomes my right when it is eligible for me to avail and I have appropriately and correctly availed it. And that's the right which accrued to me in the pre-GST regime. And hence, Shraddha, it will be my property from that perspective. Shraddha is further asking whether the applicability Limitation Act in brand equity judgment is correct according to you. Now, Shraddha, I am arguing that matter. I will always say that this Limitation Act is correct. But I think the relevant point is, Shraddha, that if you see the order, read that order. It's a beautiful order. And I am not saying whether that order is right or wrong, but it's a beautifully written order by Delhi High Court. And when it comes to the Limitation Act, the act basic, when it comes to the Limitation Act, the judgment doesn't say that the Limitation Act is applicable. And hence, Shraddha, please read very carefully the wordings used in Delhi High Court, because that will be very, very relevant when the matter is finally decided by the Supreme Court. Delhi High Court very clearly says that the guidance should be taken from the Limitation Act. It doesn't say that Limitation Act and the 3 years in Limitation Act becomes applicable, but it says that the guidance should be taken from the Limitation Act. We know for a fact that Limitation Act is applicable only with respect to the court proceedings. Now, this credit has nothing to do with the court proceedings, and hence what is relevant is the guidance to the Limitation Act, which is relevant, which is being very correctly used. So I will just go through these questions once. There are a lot of these questions which have come. So let me try ना पता चल सकता हूँ. See, there are questions which you come, what is the, can KU is writing, is GST applicable on receipt of such amount from member industries as our company only act as facilitator? So there is a question before that also. Now there is some mixing which is happening here. Let me just GST applicable on receipt of such amount from member countries as your company only act as facilitator? And I think there's one question before also. Our company will open an escrow account specifically for this project. The amount which is contributed by various industries will be deposited in respective escrow account, and the same will be transferred to the government account. See, GST is not applicable on receipt of the amount from the members, because to that extent, when the contribution happens by way of sending this money to the escrow account, there is no element of service KU. The use of that money only with respect to the service, only when there is a service, it should be subjected to GST. Manoj is writing, want to understand when GST is for place of consumption, then which state should get tax? This I have answered. So I think let's just try to see if I have missed. In case I have missed any question, please send that again to me. I think I have answered most of these questions which are there in the Q&A box. There is a question, are we allowed to claim the credit for Tran credit more than 1 year of pre-GST regime? Kanak Tara has written this. Yes, you can. P66.
डिस्कशन
सो लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड द प्रोविजंस ऑफ 369 29A ऑल्सो, बिकॉज आई थिंक दैट्स व्हाट हैज बीन लेफ्ट, एंड श्रद्धा वुड वांट टू गेट इनटू दोज डिटेल्स. लेट्स जस्ट गो टू दैट इन अ व्हाइल. बट अदर क्वेश्चंस व्हिच आर कमिंग इज ट्रांस क्रेडिट नोट मोर देन 1 ईयर टू क्लेम द क्रेडिट फॉर ट्रान क्रेडिट नोट मोर देन 1 ईयर ऑफ प्री जीएसटी रिजीम. यस, बट यू नीड टू चैलेंज. आई थिंक दिस क्वेश्चन इज रेज बाय मिस सुब्रमण्यन, बट यू विल हैव टू चैलेंज द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल वैलिडिटी टू गेट दैट बेनिफिट. देन देर इज Then there is a request from Smita to repeat this decision part, which I will repeat in a while, which is with respect to the brand equity, I think, which Smita, you are asking. There was some internet issue. Case reference, can you, we will share the document. Don't worry at all, we will share the document. Shraddha is of course writing that 366-29A. We'll come to it in a while. Don't worry, we'll not leave that. GST on ocean freight, whether we need to pay until the law settled. You need not pay as of now, or if you can pay and take the credit, do that. But if you do not want to pay, don't pay as of now, because as we speak, there is no stay on the order of Gujarat High Court, which has held it to be unconstitutional. So it's up to you. You can take the benefit of Gujarat High Court. Rahul has acknowledged for this discussion. Thank you, Rahul. Shruti is writing, if a decision has been taken by one court like the RCM on CIF ocean freight, can we implement it quoting the judgment? And generally, it's a very fundamentally good question, Shruti. It will completely depend on whether the vires of the provision has been challenged and whether the court has decided constitutional validity. If the court has decided on the constitutional validity, and any one court held in India that the provisional is unconstitutional, then that benefit can be taken by all across the country. Of course, if a provision has held to be constitutionally valid or constitutionally invalid by one court, the other court may completely deviate from the decision of the first court. That is, of course, there. But till the time there are contradicted, till the time there are no contradictory decisions, you could take the benefit. So in case of RCM on CIF ocean freight, Shruti, you can take the benefit of the Gujarat High Court, especially in light of the fact that there is no stay which is there on the decision of Gujarat High Court. Your related point is, Shruti, generally when does the GST Council acknowledge the court judgment and make changes in law? It completely depends on the issue, Shruti. Sometimes it happens that after the issuance of the notice to the respondents, the GST Council takes the decision. But sometimes it happens that only after, at a later stage, the GST Council may decide. Sometimes these issues involve discussions with larger number of states, and hence decision making also becomes a problem in few cases. But there is no set rules or parameter. But generally, it is seen that in few cases where they feel that the issue is very, very relevant and needs to be addressed, they have done that before conclusion of the hearing, or at least before filing the counter affidavit. So, billing in state A and delivery in state B. So while filing the GST, we need to quote the GST number of the customer. Yes, of course, we will have to file the GST number of the customer. And I think there is some issue which Smita wants to raise with respect to intermediary. We can come to that in case you want to give that. But now let's come to Article 366-29A, and let's just understand that what this article is, and let's just read that what this is. And I will also probably through Fiki, send this scan, 2 pages of the commentary from my book to address this. Now, if we see the provision pertaining to 366-29A, tax on the sale or purchase of goods includes a tax on the transfer, otherwise than in pursuance of a contract of property, in any goods for cash, deferred payment, or other valuable consideration. Now, this has been retained as we speak. Now, if we see the definition of goods have always been defined under Article 366-12 of the Constitution to include all material commodities and articles. Under the pre-GST indirect tax regime, the concept of deemed sale had gained special importance, and that was the time when this Article 366-29A was introduced into the Constitution to overcome the decision of various courts which had held that certain transactions would not fall within the definition of sales as per the Sale of Goods Act 30 and hence would be beyond the taxing power of the states. Now, why this provision? Now, let's just see this provision with respect to 366-29A, what it says. 29A says tax on the sale or purchase of goods includes a tax on the transfer of property. It includes works contract in B. It includes delivery of goods on hire purchase or any system of payment by installment in C. D says tax on the transfer of right to use any goods. E says a tax on the supply of goods by any unincorporated association body of person to a member thereof for cash deferred payment, which is again taxable under the GST. And F says a tax on the supply by way of or any part of any service or in any other manner whatsoever of goods being food or any other article, which was again with respect to those transactions, whether this would be within VAT or service tax and so on and so forth. So there were these specific six categories. And I am clearly writing in my commentary that it appears that the deletion of Article 366-29A has been missed. This may have very huge implications as all the items mentioned under Article 366-29A may continue as deemed sale. So now what, as far as the implications are concerned, these may be continued as deemed sales. The taxing of certain supplies in such cases may throw very interesting questions. And that's the reason that while most of these issues under the schedule to the CGST Act are very well included, whether as goods or services, I think the only a point why this has could have been retained, according to me, it looks like that this has been missed. But I think the only point is that why they would have been retained is that in case any of this reaches the court with respect to the constitutionality again, but I think the possibility of that is pretty low, because as we say, as we speak today, the right to use, works contract, transfer of property, members to the association, all of these have been addressed by the GST provisions. So as far as that is concerned, I don't see that as a challenge, but looks like only as a precautionary measure if this has been kept. But I think the deletion was missed, according to me. But I do not want to conclude whether that's a miss or not, probably only in a conservative way that has been kept to address in case any of these six transactions reach the court. Now, there is a question from Amog, Article 265, beautiful question of the Constitution of India, which mandates that no tax shall be levied or collected except by authority of law. And Amog's question is, why department reject refund on time barred? The problem is, Amog, that the time limitation is set in the statute, especially if you see the GST provision. Now, there could be two elements there, Amog, whether that amount is a refund of tax or that amount is other than the refund of tax. We know what has happened in case of Mafatlal. Now, if the amount is constitutionally invalid and hence is not a tax, then period of limitation is not applicable amount. But in case the amount becomes or remains a tax, then the limitation as per the statutory provision remains in force. Again, the question is that whether that period of limitation imposed by the court is legitimate or not, and whether guidance could be taken of the Limitation Act, which is the guiding principle even in the brand equity case argued by me. So I think that we can conclude. Either do you think that we have missed any question, or we need to address any question further? Ira, your voice is not clear. I'm really sorry. Ira, your voice is not clear.
Yeah, are you able to hear me now?
Yeah, much better.
Yeah. So I'm saying, I think, is it clear or?
So I think in case we have answered all of these questions and there are no further questions, I would request Vicky to circulate that note sheet, the reading material which was prepared to be circulated, and that will also give a reference to a lot of these issues which we have addressed and discussed today.
Yes, sure.
And I thank all the participants today for hearing out patiently and raising some very, very interesting questions, especially with respect to 360, 629A, and all of those other questions which are very relevant. I think what we should do as businesses is to see that what these issues could benefit in terms of the savings which could happen by either going to the court or making appropriate representations through FICCI and so on and so forth.
Yeah, so thank you everyone for your time. So this has been a really enriching session. I hope the voices here. Thank you everyone. I think we would also be welcoming your feedback and the listening to further. We'll also be circulating the note as Mr. Rastogi mentioned. So we'll be circulating maybe by end of today or by tomorrow, and also the recording of the session. Thank you, Mr. Rastogi, for taking out the time, and has been truly a very interesting session. I'm sure that all the participants, they have really benefited out of the discussions and various perspectives that we have taken in the session. And we would be connected with all the participants in our next sessions also. Calculating the details to you, the login details. Thank you everyone once again. Thank you everyone.
Thank you.